15, the future management development of Lochore Meadows Country Park. Mike, are you going to introduce this?
Yes, thanks, Chair. Chair, with this agreement, in a moment I'd like to invite Ben Johnston from Property Services to take us through the designs which we've been seeing from us in the schemes just now, to summarise what's actually proposed in relation to the investments in Lochore Meadows. I think that would be helpful to the committee, so your agreement. In terms of just the issues in the report, just a few words from myself. But the background to this is in the report. This goes back some time to the longer term development plan for Lochore Meadows. And within that, there's always been a priority to look at the visitor centre and to look at the old clubhouse. It's quite important to stress that the work that's going on both by the Countryside Trust, through council and trial work has always been about totality of investment in the area. It's never been solely about the visitor centre, it's always been about the juxtaposition of investments and how they support the development part going forward. And the key enabling investments made by the council are summarised in the report. There was £1 million in the 2017 budget, that same budget put £150,000 in for development of the sports pavilion in the adjacent village of Fife Park. And in the subsequent 16-19 budget, about £300,000 allocated in that. It would be mainly funding for this. The intention was that the investments would be taken forward by the Countryside Trust, partly to do the managing agent, but still have a managing agent for the Lochore Meadows, but also because it was felt that that would leverage some external funding for the project. Section 2 of the report just gives a very straightforward factual picture of the journey of this office to the point we're at today. I'm not going to go through that. I will say a couple of remarks about it. Key points within it are the fact that during 2015 it became apparent that hope for external funding will not in fact transpire. So that then would necessitate a rethink in terms of what's possible. Property Services and the Council were invited to look at the possibilities for that. They came up with a modular design which had been tried and tested previously in the Nest Nursery. There was general and broad support for that through the FCCT and also through the advisory board at the time. There was subsequent agreement to those designs back in this time last year, and really the designs that you've actually seen in the moment have not changed since then. They were subsequently endorsed by the Golf Trust and the Countryside Trust in April, and committed to us, and that then led to the filing and consultation period, which is when looking at that, what I'm setting out is based on the factual position, what happened in relation to planning consultation set out by T11. It is worth making the point that although it is a fact that nobody came back to us and there were no representations made on the designs, nonetheless, it is the case that at least two of the Queen's Council have said they wouldn't receive the retailers for that particular week. All I can say about that is we were sent out. And I can't really, short of the result of the computer, I can't really comment on that further. I think it's fair to say also that in relation to the consultation process, because there has been comment about the consultation process, that the Fife Countryside Board have accepted and it's safe to be at the advisory board, but on reflection there should have been more meetings of the advisory board in 2016. Having said that, the designs were agreed again by the advisory board early in December, and as I said, were previously agreed in January of the same year. The final part of the report really touches on some risks. But obviously, the committee will be reminded to take a different course of action than is suggested by the recommendation. All I'm saying in that part of the report is there are risks you need to be mindful of if that were to be the case. Some of those risks we can control. We can control whether or not, in that scenario, the visitor centre would need to be reopened. Some of those are out of our control. If we go to the revised tender, there is the possibility, the potential risk of increased costs. There is a situation with Sport Scotland funded, which is at risk. We circled the letter from the Scottish Government to that land review, which I think confirms the situation of funding. It is at risk. we will try and make sure that doesn't happen, but nonetheless, I have to tell you that it's a risk. Finally, there are risks which I believe to be inevitable in terms of cost. A re-tendering exercise would cost more. There's costs that have already been sunk in design terms. And obviously, if the ambition were to do something different, then that design would be too costly in terms of what that might mean. And that might mean further So that's basically the background. As I said, now by Raymond, just going to go through the designs so that members can get a feel for what was actually proposed visually. Jim.
Thanks, Mike. Just a quick introduction. Property
sales
is the
Meadows
design to procure the old two new buildings within Lochore Meadows Country Park, working closely with our clients, Cultural Trust and the Falkners. Total budget available for these projects is listed from 1 million for the visitor centre and 669,000 for the football pavilion. Both buildings, as you can see, are designed in-house by the same architects group that successfully delivered Windmill Community Garden and Skeleton Centre, the other high schools and numerous other high profile projects. Our architects followed due process throughout. Affordable outline scheme signed off by our clients in early 2016. The project has been strictly cost managed throughout the design process to ensure that we deliver affordable buildings. It's very important to understand in this financial climate there is no point in our architects designing schemes that are significantly over budget. What's been produced, for your information, I put a couple of our artists' impressions on the screen. These impressions are also prepared by an in-house architect. Impressions provide a useful insight into our proposals both internally and externally. As you see it running through, you can see the visitor centre and some insight to the visitor centre also externally. So from the interactive centre will be within the visitor centre and also the golf football ground. There's also a photograph there. Sometimes with our Revit system, it's not very advanced now, what we can actually show in these, but sometimes the colour doesn't come over exactly right, so that's a little bit of picture on exactly how the plan would look. There's absolutely no doubt that the proposed visitor centre is smaller than the existing, but architects have worked very hard to balance functionality, architectural vision, and the budget. Deliver our best value on these projects. The existing facility was bigger, but 260 square metres was not accessible to the public, and 150 square metres was wasted circulation areas. The new visitor centre has a large modern cabinet and can be doubled in size if required. The building also has an interpretation area to reflect the history of the park. The golf football pavilion is a project that will provide two changing rooms and shower areas to Sports Scotland standards. The building also has an education multi-purpose room, refereeing, changing, professional golf shop and golfers' training area. The building is very much an integrated facility between football and golf as well. The construction, Fife Council, as you know, are at the forefront of maximising the benefits of all off-site fabrication, i.e. manufacturing large components of the buildings and delivering these to site. These are huge advantages this approach and very much the direction of travel for the construction industry. You actually see a detailed go-around of how we're going to actually build the visitor centre. And including a slide of the proposed construction of the visitor centre, it's completely untrue to suggest this building is a temporary structure. It is very much a permanent structure that is designed for over 40, 50 years. The external walls of the building will be built off-site, but the structure will be supported from a steel frame. You can see from the slide how the building was put together. The golf football building will be a timber kitchen structure, again maximises everything we believe and benefits of off-site fabrication. Building by its very nature makes it easier to extend in the future either towards the play park or the lock to us as a procurement. A number of allegations have been made against the procurement of these buildings. The answers to a procurement approach, why we procured both buildings together, value for money, other council's costs, etc, etc, have been robustly answered by myself. Briefing that issued yesterday. The QSEs who work in this building have over 100 years of public procurement experience on our site. I also have correspondence from Highland Council who confirm that they simply do not produce buildings for the prices quoted and are categorically backed our cost per square meter allowances. So where are we now? Our legal acceptance for the project currently set on hold to appoint a local contractor carry out these works. I'd explain to the Dairy Forum and Advisory Board their options to address only the golf football pavilion and put on hold the visitor centre, but this will pay additional costs for the project. Splitting the buildings will pay additional preliminary costs, redesign fees, money will require to be spent on the open existing centre, and construction inflation will continue to keep the set budget. At both meetings that I've attended with the Forum Group and Advisory Group, I've made it very clear that I'm more than happy to work with the community to alleviate their concerns over the functionality and cadence of the building. We have an opportunity to both work with myself, our designers, our local contractor, and the Forum to produce two buildings that are an asset for life.
Proposing to take questions first, questions to the officers, and then put forward a recommendation on the questions first before the motion to the table on issues.
Thanks, Chair. We've obviously been a great deal of debate and discussion before. There are a great deal of questions that have been, I believe most people have something to answer to. The lack of consultation, the due size of the building, the prefab, or lack of design for the new building, and it certainly appears to be an issue with the timescales for the new building. In particular, there's been a certain amount of talk about using Sports Scotland funding. The project has an allocation of 1.769 million, and yet there seems to be a concern that we will lose 82,000 from Sports Scotland. Which, if you listen to what has been said by some people, this could completely scupper the project. My understanding is that Sports Scotland are far from threatening to move this funding and are more than happy to discuss an extension. So, firstly, has Fife Council requested a further extension of this 83,000 from Sports Scotland? My next question is, who will be looking after the Meadows at the public meeting on the 5th of December? There's a representative from the Fife Coast and Countryside Trust. There's a great deal to say about certain points, but absolutely nothing to say on whether they were going to continue running meetings, which I find strange that a mere 9 days later they removed themselves from the mansion of the meetings. 2.4 in the report, this extension was estimated to cost 1.342 million, excluding that from Fife Council. We're responsible for 1 million of this funding, and the Fife Coast and Countryside Trust are responsible for securing the balance of 342,000 from the extent of funding sources, including a failed application for the Scottish Government Regeneration Capital Grant Fund. Can you tell me when this application was made to the Scottish Government? Who made the application? How much the application was for, and what grounds? And what were the grounds for rejection? What costs were involved in reopening the existing visitor centre after the pre-demolition asbestos checks? And finally, there is a solution to this. The planned site of traffic loop clubhouse and associate parking at Glen Cree, which none of the residents wanted, is put on hold for the possibility of a review for this to go into the news instead. This would save costs and a new clubhouse and associate parking. As I say, the seedings could then be put into a bigger resource centre and fit the purpose for the meadows.
Okay, there's a number of points there. Do you want to come back on the specific questions just now?
So there's two aspects to that. So Grant comments on the funding aspect, what's got on the plan, but the financial funding remained on the...
Please. The position of £20,000 worth of active policies funding set out in the report, so I don't know if you're saying anything to the report, to what's being said in letters to circulated to oversight, which was from the sports minister in the county to the earnings before the 22nd of December. The formal position is that we're giving one extension today, and also recognise the challenge of editors trying to move to create. Human process, the key ones we can see the opening and the changes to move forward. That extension I'm very clear that we need to complete the project by the end of February, and we're clear in a position to be able to do that now. So there is a natural resource of pressure submitted for this, and I think £3,000. responsible for sorting out, they want to see where we go as of today. So whatever the decision the committee council will be, we'll see that as well as one of us. So this is where we are. We are hopeful that maybe something's going to think that £2,000 of sorting out on the table. We can't guarantee that. And just to reinforce the point, the position is very clear. And I see the standard right now, we are not. In terms of the Scottish Regeneration Capital Fund, I need to come back on the precise date, but from memory, the application and decision-making process was in the summer school court in March 2015. The application was made by the Micro Skills and Trust. It was alongside three or four other applications that came to support for, one of which was to be closing samples of the UK, which was successful in going down some funding, but the other one is and that's put forward or not.
Can you come back to me with the reasons why it wasn't successful? Or do you not have that to hand?
I don't have that to hand, the feedback from the from Scottish Government as to why it didn't receive funding. Fundamentally, there's a limited amount of money available for each energy and local authority. So when you put in 4 or 5 million, you think that has to be ranked for the award. That's not a, they don't necessarily say to follow that authority order, but it's certainly going to take into account, and certainly the proposal cycle service is higher than the other than the discussion centre. So there's a limit to how many projects can actually be supported through also relatively small amounts of money.
Beyond the perception, there's a comment back, there's a special legal requirement for the public working to introduce it to get the subject. If you do that all buildings, the opportunity when FCC can move out the building, of course, get in there to do this intrusion survey. You know, that demolition survey, you can imagine it is pretty. So they're trying to find every bit of space that they're getting back to get this building. So they'll go right through doors. So if you are presenting them or something, you can do this up. Also, we have to mitigate traffic. Some lighting and some heat in that area that we need to fund all that work as well. So we, a few essays, are about 120 pounds that we need to see.
The other issue was about the management and the report forward. Just coming on to where we are, what we're going to do.
Briefly, adjusted the emergency of what is a very surprise agreement, which should be 2 years. That was extended for the first 12 months until the end of March this year. Our board meeting in December, 16th of December, was the first board decided that we wish to manage the park beyond the contract of the year. So they will withdraw at that point and manage the park along the way to the council. First of April, the responsibility for managing the park will be
good. Okay, Neil Crooks.
Just a question. I would have thought someone as big as this would have been advertised somewhere. So, can you tell me if there were plans of anything on public display at any point in the event that was? Or will not make a notice?
I'll take a couple good attempts.
Just building if those are something I obviously have been to the park in the past, but could somebody just clarify we're talking about an advisory board, we're talking about the forum, we're talking about community councils, could somebody just explain to me how all of these fit together? were people who are now objecting to this, were they not involved at all in this process? As, you know, as I would have expected that they would have been. Could I also refer to Councillor Mary Lockhart's letter, which I think we all got yesterday. I wasn't quite sure Chair Mary was going to be here today and speak to us, but she is. But she talks about, just quoting her, her perception was that an undertaking was given on behalf of Fife Council, by which I feel bound to local councillor. So who was it who gave that undertaking? And she goes on to say, if there was not support, then the development would be halted. So could somebody clarify that for us, please?
Come back to us.
In terms of the plans, 2.11 report refers to the seen on the slide. I think the inspector and the golf club for the year of 5 months. Plans also made available through the section of the 90% of those who have requested to be brought by Dr. Services in June. So the plans have been out there in the public, obviously the planning application process as well, and as the report also mentions, the court stakeholders have been involved in the board, and the plans within my introduction, you see in front of me now, a lot of change in the last year, which of course is
my role has been said by the partnership, I was the chair of MPP, also I'm chair of the advisory board since that we started on the
Correct me if I got that wrong, which could ensure an invaluable level of flexibility so that an additional building could be added in future, so that the additional use made of the building could be even more interesting. So I'd be really grateful if you could tell me if I've got that right, and maybe a bit more information, a few more technical terms than I have used.
Okay,
there's any difference in those two contributions, can I come back with a response? In terms of the 263 years, and that's to our beef that we're trying to maximise broadcast by maintaining a functional building, so that's what the architects want to do. Most of the budget of the yes, it can be extended to one point and the sort of north. The off-site fabricated panels that have come in, they'll be fabricated in a factory, they'll be brought in and one way straight in. So this building is slightly different from a fully modular building, which would be like what we built over at Community Centre. We just finished there last month. That's a full modular building. So we're following off site fabrication, and we have to match it to the site conditions. In this particular one, we're also repairing existing foundations and floor slab on the visitor centre, again to try and maximise the benefits of what we've got. So it's a steel frame, we're off site fabricated units, and they're bolted straight in. The nature of it is very easy to extend as well. The offsite fabrication for us, the benefits is that it's different than our fuel sites. If you bring these in, then the fuels are still working. Some of them come straight in. Sunflower Nursery School just up the road from here. The whole building's erect in a week. So these panels come in, they're put up, and that's massive advantages for us on time scale to be offsite and away from the school far quicker. Also, the quality of the build, sustainability. The tolerances to build them in factories is far better. And these guys are not putting them up in terms of thermal weather conditions. They're put together in factory conditions. Health and safety, far less concerns on site, far less moving parts. And so, off site fabrication is a big one of the construction industry.
The advisory board is advising the trust and the capacity of the managing agent for the park on a range of issues in around operational policy development side of this. So he comprises a number of representatives from the NRL community, which are set out in paragraph 2.3.1, which is the opportunity forum, to have a thing directly to do with the park here in the management sense. It's a group within the community who represent the interests of the community and will work on and around taking the issues there, particularly interest in the public and the community.
Consultation, I need that answer.
Yeah.
So, can I come in here? Just very quickly, because I think I'm going to cut through some of this stuff. The meeting on the trip, so the advisory board is made up of representatives of local community councils, the NARTI forum, and there's also representatives of local so there's local councils on that as well. One of the representatives on the is a representative of the NARTI forum. That member was present on the 20th of January. The role of those representatives is meant to feed back from the advisory group back into the community groups and take any excitement to the community with regards to any issues. So the design document they made on the 20th of January, the issue went back to the NARTI forum after the 20th of January last year. The big issue that we've got here is not that where we are with the design, it's a length of time that has taken that community group to come back, because the first I became aware that for anyone in the community had an issue with regards to the design of the building was a letter in the Secretary of Five Times at the end of October. So that's 8 months after the meeting that we're at, before I'm signing off the meeting of the advisory board, signing off the design. So that, for me, that's a bit I'm concerned about, is how long the fight can that last.
Okay, I mean, I think that clarifies some of the issues. The outstanding question is still that there was the accusation that no official turned up at one of the public meetings. Can we answer that?
Yes, there were two public meetings. Dex mentioned in the report there was lots of representation. The first, they gave the college of titles and such as when I agreed to send a smaller group of representatives from the first public meeting to sit down with council officers, both my staff and Ray and his staff, to go through their concerns about the design in some detail. Second voting meeting, to which Alison and my dear one of my colleagues practically in such a very short notice, often when they lead you to the private members, I'm a sports partnership manager. So that was unfortunate, that was just where we were. Equally, I think there was a sense that I'm not too sure, we weren't too sure at that point, what would you react to it, to the debate, you know, being the first meeting, we spent something like 3 hours with the representatives of the group.
Can I just hold there? I'm conscious this is going on, and we'll go on some considerable time within kind of 5 minutes of the canteen shop in your hands as to whether we press on or whether short break. Press on. Okay. I have a number of people.
I need to go back in the consultation to keep myself out here. I've asked this question. Now, I've dealt with consultations, especially within the health service. I would never go to a meeting without an official of a change in something.
Andrew, that's not a question. No, there's a number of other people. You've been in once. Can we give the other people a chance that they might answer your questions as well? But Dave Dempsey.
Chair, trying to navigate your way through the noise and fog surrounding this, and as far as I can see, there are strands to this whole business. There's the business of consultation and interaction with the public, over which there's contention, comes in. There's the provision of a new visitor centre, about which there's contention and upset, and there's the golf and football pavilion. Am I right in thinking that that is not a source of the public concern? That one is pretty much agreed. Is that correct?
No, it's correct. Thank you.
Okay, Leslie.
I'm
going to
go back to the consultation then. I guess trying to sort of pick up on whose responsibility to do what. So, if I read this correctly, we have an advisory committee which comprises members from community councils and local councillors and school, RAG and Police Scotland. We have, therefore, representatives who go back to their community councils post those meetings. So I suppose my question is, what updates did the respective community councils get from the advisory group post that meeting in January, and what actions were discussed and limited as a result of that? And who is on the I guess what that suggests is there are people on the advisory council who are also on the community council. So who's also on the minority forum, and are they some of the same people who are on the advisory committee and on the community council? And I guess my question would be for the folks at the back. They've clearly got an interest in our filming, so do you sit on any of these
I sit on the community council.
We're not here to question the public gallery.
But I guess I'm just trying to understand.
Community council, which was never informed.
So what I'm trying to understand is, what was the chain of expectation of communication? So when we talk about, clearly there should have been more, I think we all recognise there should have been pick up and consultation. But clearly, by having representatives go along to all of these events, information was known. The second point I want to touch on is the planning piece. So the weekly list, and everyone sitting around here gets the weekly list. And in my experience in my community councils, if anyone never got the weekly list, they'd be filling up asking why. But notwithstanding that, errors can happen, you miss an email, people are busy, and I get that. But clearly, again, that weekly list is a pre-programmed thing, it just goes out. So even if that was missed, and we assume that it was, it was then on display in the park for 5 months. So my question, if it was on display in the park 5 months, loads of people over that summertime surely must have seen those plans and must have thought either that, yeah, I like that, or no, I don't like that, or I wonder how I can find out more about that. Because I understand in the park, having visited the park, it was there for people to view and comment on. And my understanding is that no objections were there for the scene. So my question really comes back to, why have we waited till October when the plans were originally approved in the January? Because there is a bit here which is, we've also had information sent to us which has been responded to by the officer, which basically has set out a position which has been proven, I think, by some of the other information not to be accurate. So as a member having to look at this, I just want to understand the full scheme of who is supposed to do what happened and why, and what happened and didn't.
I think there's still confusion on some of the previous questions about this, and I think Leslie's clarified now. Can you, before that, take other people to want to have another go at clarifying those kind of points, please?
Are we not allowed to state?
No. Sorry.
I thought you'd come back to the report and try to set that in the conversation of the So the meeting of the advisory board on the 20th of January last year was critical. That's the green light. There was a process of discussion going on many months before that, probably years actually, but a couple of years before that, originally proposed to be the FCCT proposition, which wasn't delivered to the city of the 2030, when we made that. That principle was agreed by the advisory board back in July 2015. That one was, it was incentive, if you like, to go away through property to develop design plans for the sewer today. Those design plans in retail came back to the advisory board on the 20th of January last year and were endorsed. That's then the result for us to take that forward and to start to deliver the project. It gets a little more complicated after that because at some point in April, we took a view that the better value of delivering two projects to one contract and two projects separately. There's also the piece of consistent design, such as across the whole field, they're not too far away from each other in the park. So the green light, January last year, we're moving forward with the property to finalise the designs. I think from the council's point of view and the trust point of view, the meeting in January was very significant because that's the green light to get things moving forward. Parallel to that, there was going to be a report for yourselves and the council mentioned, there was various information from the public domain that was on display, was extensive from the media, that proposition that the science had moved the facilities into the park. And as council was alluded to, until late summer, early autumn, there was there was any dissent to what we were trying to do in the park in the centre. golf trusts that are going to be a benefit to the rates and the city to one after the college council takes the lead. Get to the proposition of the million pounds of the trust for the project.
Process is robust when we're faced with all of these comments claiming that it wasn't.
Okay, I've got Brian Poole. Brian, to
really the question.
Oh, sorry. So I'm not clear, well, it's not really about the question for our officer then, because I'm not clear at all at this stage why this has been resisted. Because the consultation seems to be I'm looking for pressure. If people are going to oppose this here, I would want to know why has it been resisted and what should have been done that's not been done. And that's not clear to get this.
I think you'll maybe get that in part of the debate afterwards, but I mean there are a number of questions. Yeah, there's a number of questions there from Fife and on the 83,000 if you want to respond to.
I don't think the 83,000 is very, very well. Absolutely. If you take the letter of the letter of law in terms of the issue that's actually on the grounds today, depending on what to do on that, we have opened this further dialogue with school, so I mentioned earlier that we will find a decision today in terms of where we're going with the project, sit down with it again. There is a significant risk of a rule, Mr. Money, equally, there's hopefully a chance that you may receive
very quick.
So, if this was delayed and I have to go into a re-tender, and it's a subjective question to you guys, but presumably there will be the concern that the tender will come in at a higher price. Is that your concern? And what's the evidence for that in the case? issue about what authority you had and the scope of the commitment you gave in that context.
Yeah, I mean, in the meeting, it was quite clear that the room, the number of people in that meeting were very clear that the majority in that room obviously certainly didn't want that to go ahead, and it came to that meeting with a specific agenda to stop that project.
because we wanted to stop it going ahead, because it, for whatever reason, whatever, we didn't like it. I think there's a number of issues that come up, most of them have been kind of squashed by officers, but so for me, in that meeting, what I said was, if there was effectively told by the public, then we wanted to go ahead. I simply say that we wouldn't go ahead with that. The problem that we've got is it's quite clear that the public are fairly divided on it. And on that case, for about a year, we wouldn't make a decision.
Karen.
Thanks. I'm going to stand it up. I'm sure we're going to stand up today.
Yeah.
I just had a wee bit of clarity on the public display aspect. In section 211, it mentions that the plans, elevations, etc., are put on display for a period of 4 months in the visitor centre. Now, I've been told by one of the people who's got in touch with me that they have concerns about whereabouts within that visitor centre the display was displayed. So I'd like clarity of where exactly they were on display. Is this a place where the public actually pass by on a regular basis? And what the officer's definition of public display is? And this is a sort of a process thing. I think we need to take cognizance of this for any display of public plans, if it is actually public, that people know about it, they know where it is, they're pointed in the right direction. And then we build into that the fact that we're also being told that it's possible that the Benefit Centre were given copies to show people if they did inquire. So that's another concern from that process in perspective. Like, did we get that part of this process right?
This is for to actually get officers in this council to give me the reasons for this. So I'll read out this paragraph from Willie Farr. There have been two public meetings in the community with standing room only to express the concern about the proposed development. When it was announced that no council official would come out and meet the community to discuss a solution that's going to rise to people's anger that they are being ignored by the council. What I want to know for officers, although you could not attend on these evenings, did you facilitate at any point to say to the whoever to say, by the way, can we meet you at some other point? Because we can't meet on these nights because we've got prior engagements. Because that then would say to me quite clearly that anybody could be at another meeting, I'd have to go and meet this officer. But if you could tell me that you could say, well, what we did was ask offered another meet, did that happen? Did it not happen?
Just to
rewind
to what I said earlier, Andrew, between the two-point meetings, there was a 3-hour plus meeting with officers and representatives from the committee to walk through in significant detail the designs you see, the issues that are concerned. At the end of that meeting, in black and white, we offered if there's any information, any further information, anything you're not clear about, come back to us and we're happy to sit down at another meeting in a short space of time between the first meeting and the second public meeting. That topic wasn't taken up. I think we've always been clear out of the end of the year from the officers. So if there are two cooking sat behind us on the end of the meeting, we're going to sit down and have a discussion with the officers or the other councils. They're happy to facilitate that.
So nobody came back to me.
Right, we'll take
Brian's little question, just again. Yeah, it was just really clarity. I think it was mentioned earlier that between the two governments, the wrong and the ball government seems to be generally less concerned about the ball. Is that feedback that the government? Well, I think for me that highlights the fact that there's been a process here that's worked in part, but obviously not whole, and I think there are others that we're going to be trying to solve the part that hasn't worked, and that doesn't help me really to be able to do it. I do hope it's a solution that will work to make sure that the bit that's been positive for the seat can be dealt with and deliver. And that may mean that it's looking at a different way of running the whole overall package. Examine the process whereby the proposal for the new visitor centre and integrated clubhouse changes to the way were developed with a view to learning lessons for future projects. Can I have a seconder for that? Okay, are there any amendments to that?
Yeah, well, I want to move an amendment, which reads, the committee agrees to form the board contract for the integrated clubhouse and changes the building. Agree that the current visitor centre be reinstated with the new development pushing forward pending final community consultation. In addition, the executive committee agrees a review of the location of the planned cycle track in Wednesday in order to investigate potential for larger development at the Lochore Meadows.
Is there a seconder for that?
Yeah.
Right,
quite well. We're in the danger of conflating two issues that are actually related to the issue in hand here. I don't think you can wonder that about the second part that isn't part of this. We are specifically dealing with this.
Chair, there are some questions. The original looks. Local Meadows visitor.
Microphone.
Sorry.
We originally looked at Lochore Meadows as a potential venue for the cycle circuit, but it was ruled out because of wind conditions.
Right, okay, just let's go.
Well, Jim, I think today's I'm not really clear at what stage we are with the electric project.
This is really clear, isn't it?
Yes, the contract, the tender prices are back, and we're currently not awarded the contract yet. There's a shortfall on funding between the tender costs and the available budget, and we're having discussions internally about how best to try and bridge that gap. Also, I'm assuming to award the contract until such time as that funding has been bridged.
The person that sent the thing out was decent enough to say he's not an expert,
And when we got the replies back through property services to the suggestions that were being made about value for money, it was pretty obvious that guys are an expert. But the contribution that had been made like that was enough in my mind to stir up a community to make objections based on what were being presented to them as facts. What we've had now is facts presented to us by professional staff who have got a track record second to none in the whole of Scotland about delivering projects in schools, delivering projects like Overton Community Centre, and they have got a track record to be proud of, and they were called into question, which I find objectionable. That would be called into question just left me a wee bit off line a wee bit. Baby Johnson has presented to us the facts, and the old Dutch what property people do. And the facts are that we've got a proposal on the table to develop at Lochore Meadows, something which will be massively beneficial to the whole of Fife, and probably wider, as people come to Lochore from all over the country. And I've got no doubts whatsoever that supporting this will be beneficial, not just to the local community, but to the wider community in Fife. And I certainly support the recommendation that David was moving. And I've got no problem. I quite agree with people having the opportunity to express different opinions. That's how life should be. You know, if you've got a different opinion on it, that's life, and it's fine. But we have to draw conclusions as councillors about the investments that we're making, where we get value for money, and we take professional advice on that. And the professional advice I definitely take, and I think we move forward with a project that is going to have a terrific, positive impact on the whole of Fife.
Good. Andrew Roger.
I've listened to what's been said here today, and really, as I say, I came in with an open mind, but listening to officers, I'm convinced that the officers have done their utmost in this situation to do the right thing by this council. And also, to me, it's a really good story in a sense. Before that about the caves. 20 odd years we've looked for something like this. And what we're hearing now just at the end as well is that if this doesn't go ahead, there could be a form of the risk that the money is coming from other organisations to prop up this money. And quite clearly, I just feel that what's been presented here, I think it's a great design in a sense. The positive fact is it could be added to it if there's a bit needs to be added to it, it could be added in the future. But to put all the suggestions on the table, let's not go ahead and let's think again, and then the money floats out the door again. I'm sorry, but the point is that I will be supporting this for the simple reasons that this is what Neil said as well. We've got officers here who know their job inside out, get us value for money in a sense, and as I say, I believe they've done the utmost within the community. I don't know if anybody's been playing games, I just don't know what's been happening there at all, but what I'm hearing from officers, they've done the most to put it there, ask to come back to people who want to put their bit of contribution. So right through the game, as I say, we've tried to do the best, and plus the fact as well, as I say, this advisory group, where I think there's quite a few people sitting there from the community as well. I had no concerns about it, so quite clearly, it was in my ear, I'd welcome this. Sorry.
Good deal, Andy.
Thanks, Chair. What is this? Neil, I interrupted him, but when you introduced to something that's clearly not true, it's a kind of immediate reaction to respond. The situation that we've got in front of us is not just about the local community, it's important for our fibre, because all of us will go to the clinics, we all use it, and I think I just want to shift the focus away from the minutiae, the details of people who went focus on the basic principles. Is it good enough for a room full of people? I know we're elected representatives for our community, but is it good enough for us to say, oh, well, we like that, particularly in the face of not heard about ones and twos, contact us, heard very clearly about rooms full of people opposed to this scheme. And I think, you know, if there are question marks about community involvement engagement within that, even if we say we tick the boxes of process that we've been through, there are clearly some concerns about commitments that have been given and whether they're being honoured now or not. And that is a disservice to all of us if we make commitments that we cannot keep. And that's absolutely clear to me that mistakes have been made during this process, and that it's not been as transparent as it would be right. I think it's a perfect opportunity not to press ahead with something that could be the wrong fit for this facility, because it is so important for all of us. It's really important to get it absolutely right. And if, because of however well-intended an engagement process the consultation was, if it's because of it was explored in some way and then we didn't get the comments that we're now getting, then we need to take cognizance of that. We can't just say, well, no, you had your chance, we're not listening now. That's not good enough. I think that the suggestion from Councillor Bain about co-locating the cycle track has a very good adjacency with some of the other cycling activity that's being planned for the site. I think that should be given due diligence. I understand that the Great Craig site has concerns about its suitability for the cycle track anyway, so there are perhaps other issues that can do with there. But I think fundamentally at the heart of this is we can't be perceived or be seen to be doing something to communities instead of with them. And that's fundamentally the key thing here, is there's a fundamental issue about the number of people who do not feel that they are being listened to, and I feel very uncomfortable about ignoring that. I think that there's an opportunity, there needs to be an opportunity to step back from the process, reassess the situation, to look for a better fit and a better opportunity, because if we're going to one of the other points that's raised in the paper is about how we promote, but one of the challenges from the trust was that how the site is managed, how it's promoted and used. If we're not getting that bit right either, then the numbers of potential visitors could be much greater, and therefore it's even more important to get the facility right with all of that taken into consideration. But I think the final thing and the most important thing is a commitment was given to the community at a meeting that if they were not happy, that it would be paused, it would be stopped, and it wouldn't proceed until they were happy. Now, that commitment, whoever made it in whatever term, that commitment was given, and we've got a responsibility to take that into any consideration, and I think we have to honour that commitment absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay,
Linda.
Chair, thank you. In terms of the Meadows, there's a number of things that concern me. We have representatives of the community that need actually actually drive, so the community have been involved in this process all the way, and they voted in favour of this to go out. There's issues, and I have to say, I'm just concerned that the issue that I think is being in the United Centre, the plans wasn't as good as it should have been. However, anybody that went into and is familiar with the media centre, you've got an entrance on, you can't miss, you couldn't miss the actual design. And I've done it there at least 30 times. And we certainly haven't to plan, but I have to comment on it because actually I didn't have any objection. Now, there are loads of people that go in there, and people that walk there every day, that cycle there every day, that run there every day, that are happy with that, but they didn't put any comments up. And actually, we're in danger of it. If we accept what Neil's proposing, Neil Harvey has, that we'll never get another family thing through again because we'll always be calling it back. The reality is that the information and the plans were shown for months and there were no objections, absolutely none. And I have to say, as a councillor, because I was asked by somebody who runs a website about how many objections I had received. Now I received a correspondence from Mr. Kinnaird, which has been utterly refuted by the officers we have, and I have to say that I have taken very strong cognizance information that was actually presented in there, because it's factual. The information was there, and everybody is around the table must have received that, and I don't think we put that to one side. I received yesterday one objection from a lady in Cabinet, And on Friday last week, I received an objection from the meeting that I did. All the other discussions I've had with constituents, whether it be on phone, through the subsidies, have been positive. There was no objection raised at the Community Council either. What the Community Council wanted, both that we discussed at the Community Council, was a support for campaign for facilities which are suitable for the location. And I believe that they are suitable, given that they are actually modular and can be added to when we have the money. And we have to work within the money that we've got. It would be wonderful to have an extra £1 million to add on to that. We put £1 million aside. I think certainly in terms of the golfing community and the football community, they are absolutely in favour of this going ahead. So I personally think that we should be going ahead with it as a user of the whole Meadows, where I go very often and I certainly take a handshake from the price at weekends.
Thank you, Chair. For the past, confirmed earlier, there are three strands to this. There is the consultation to get all the action of the project, which has to have the cost rate, and the great objection is written to that. There's the golf football element, which again, there's some getting contention about what we're going into that. And there's this visitor centre. The question for me is, whether the public concern and disquiet about this is sufficient, and that it should be paused and re-examined, and eventually proceeded with at a greater cost than what it would be. And so the question is the balance between the concern and the benefits of getting on with it and saving good money. And it's difficult for me as an outsider to gauge the situation in our key area. However, I have in front of me, as we all do, an opinion from someone who clearly is an authority in our key area, in the shape of Willie Clark. My reading of his letter is that would be that this should not go ahead in the present form. It should take stock of the visitor centre element and come to an answer that has the widespread support of the community, which is the first behind the event of the vote.
Chair, thank you. I too am concerned. I mean, I think it's sad. It's unfortunate we've gotten to this point. We haven't actually heard what Fife Coastal Countryside Trust are recommending, or by inference are they recommending approval. I'm conscious that Councillor Laird is a member of that group that's declared an interest in it. I know they're going to put it in that responsibility. I'm still sad that if it had been one of my community councils, I would have made it my business to have gone back to the community council and said, I am the leaders. I don't know the way in which councils operate in your area, but it would appear that didn't happen. But for whatever reason, were unproductive. I remain concerned, I think, as the others here, that we have a split community. We've seen that a lot of people are not happy with this, and I would prefer that there is further discussion about it. My point is, I don't know enough about the cycle path proposal, so I have no idea whether that is something that I could support. But as David has just said, we've got a letter from Woody Clark saying that we should hold on. And also we have a letter from Councillor Mary Lovett who feels that we should pause this. So I think get on with the football and the golf, but I personally think we should take more time on this issue.
Fee,
might that
not?
Just echoing those sentiments, you're accused of this being a party political stunt. I'm not sure which fact is filling us up when we've got representation from around the Labour group saying that this should be halted. We're told that we shouldn't be objecting to this now, the community shouldn't be objecting to this now, because it was signed off by a board made up of various different local organisations, as well as three ward councillors and the chair of the area committee. Well, the chair of the area committee at the time has also written to us saying, it appears that the present development does not have the support of the community. It isn't far-seeing enough to realise that the money being invested does not solve the problems at present. We're being told by councillors and former councillors in this area that it does not represent the wishes of the community. So I really do feel that I could support a proposal that ignores that.
Alternate.
Thanks, Chair. Just going along on my way in, my happy face on. I met the professor outside, and I've got two faces I don't want, and I'm not sure much. I met the professor outside, I don't cure the new game. Anyway, the point of making is that I wouldn't suggest that it was a political group that I met outside. They had concerns, and I think it's always important to listen to these. Sometimes they're helped along the way by political reasons, and that's fine too, because it happens everywhere. All campaigns would be a bit of that. However, what I would like to do is just take a couple of moments of going through the process. We've had consultation. We've had the chair who's now changed his mind, who's got the time, I'm a national treasurer, who's changed his mind about what he thinks about this, but he was on the board who passed it last January. And for me, I think that's quite difficult to sort of find my way around. But let's leave that aside. We've got some in the community unhappy about it, and we've got some in the community who felt it necessary to set up their own Facebook page saying positive things about me. So for me, this isn't a drag note, it's just a flipping mess. But the consultation element of it, it wouldn't matter what consultation you did, because there's always going to be people say, oh, I never knew. We have a thing in our local plan for 900 houses, or in the strategic land use thing, and nobody noticed until well after then. So I don't know how we get it better, other than practically writing to everyone. For me, the costs are the issue. I listened carefully to all things, and it's not great, but £150,000 to restore the asbestos invasion and this stuff that we put it back to the concern after, just nod from Neil in the right part. Yeah. £150,000 on the cost to do this in two halves, apart from disruption, roughly. And £83,000 off, you're not getting it anymore. And we can take the 83 out, just £150,000 extra cost. We're trying to get the best value for the community. So that's what we should be focusing on. I think the centre for those luckily, it's just a centre. I've seen loads of them, like one of them, to be honest. But there are lots of them around the place. So the design part's not important to me. The additional costs bother me. I don't see the point in just sort of stopping to add on £250,000 of costs if we can deliver a centre that would probably become much more once we're using it. It's better than setting up on the ground and doing the job. So for me, I can't in any sort of conscience say, let's stop spending like £250,000 before we start looking for the general money to be found. I'm not inclined to conflate it with any other project, and I think it's scurrilous to do so. And it is. From that point, for me, David's point is where we should push the button on this and we should get on with it and try and find a way to bring people together to use the centre of what it's for. And that's the bit we're going to have to try and deal with some things with. It's not being effective, of course it's not. Nothing to do with it, is, but the club, the football, the cricket people, of course they're happy, they're getting the change in facilities. So these are non-contentious. We just need to get together, get in a room, let's put the consultation failures at that. That's how we view them, to the side and see how we're going to make this work. So for me, I think we do that, and we have to learn from it, because there's too many of these where we said, you know what, can you consult it, can you got it right, but we're getting better at each time, this season, we are getting better at it. A lot better than some of the constitutions I've had to go up in the past. So we're getting better, but in this case, I think to wait is just the wrong choice. It's the wrong motivation, it's the highest possible to do.
Can you, David?
Have you got another battery?
Yeah. I've been here for a long time, but don't think I've ever seen a community ask or post something that you guys are going to be great for them. That doesn't make sense, does it? And the fans to say that all these guys have been wound up doesn't make sense. Communities don't act like that. So let's accept, I think we're accepting now, there's opposition to this. To start off with, there's no really it. But now we know what they're supposed to do.
Can we let David?
Right. You can't make folk come and do this unless they want to, unless they feel strong with their own community. That just can't happen. The idea that we get it wrong maybe in terms of time, spend that money, spend a couple of million, rather than doing it right, doesn't make sense to me either. You do it right. Because if you get it wrong, you spend it wrong, you never recover. We have to leave enough financial capital disasters in this council to tell us that, by the way. We start doing it right. And the community are with us when we do it right. It's as simple as that. I don't think we can go in its present state. It doesn't make any sense. It really doesn't.
Okay, Mark.
Thanks, Chair. I mean, I've got a few comments to make, but I could just start by thanking the officers. There's been a lot more heat around this than we like over the last couple of months, and to be quite honest, if we put up with some sort of allegations, which quite frankly, I've just already said, we don't care anybody coming up to their work. And I think the cowardly thing is that a lot of these people who have made these allegations continue to make them, citing them on the facts. And I think that's a real issue for me with regards to how certain members, or very, very few members within the community, have conducted themselves during this process. Consultation. This document is a document that went to the advisory board on the 20th of January. You can see the design there. Basically the same design as what we've mentioned today. That meeting was attended by a number of reps, including Mr. Donald Clark at the time, and the representative of the forum. For the minute of that meeting, one of the last paragraphs, the advisory board agreed that they are happy with the proposed design and we are happy for work to continue on the project as planned. That, for me, says a lot about where we were in January last year, and the consultation no fair at that point raised any concern about the consultation, the lack of consultation that was going on at that time. Now, I believe that there was fairness for the consultation. I think we could have done much more for the gas consultation, but we are where we are.
No.
However, I think what has surprised me more today is the SNP's amendment to complete the second with the visitor centre. And let me just start. We stuck to our guns because we believe that along with the investment that we've put into the local Meadows around the mountain bike trails, and I think there's a bit of confusion around bike trails, like something that's in the bike trail, we are completely different. Okay? So the investment of 130,000 in the mountain bike trails that have gone there, and alongside that, having a facility for road bikes and the cycle centre that we've played was seen as by Cycle Scotland and Sports Scotland as being a real good. So the site identified by Sports Scotland with regards to the site along with us. So Sports Scotland and Scottish Cycling have been sitting in the room with regards to the cycle centre project for probably around 2 years now. And every one of those meetings, we took that. And for us now to go back to that at this stage and suggest that actually we're going to move it someplace else is probably longer, probably the worst of the agency I've heard in the last 10 years of the councillor. I don't understand how some councillors could even come up with that as a possible proposal. They seem to know nothing about what's going on in the community, quite frankly.
Right, 1 minute,
Mark. Okay, so for me, let's go back. We made a commitment that, for me, we needed to know that the public were completely against it. What's tarnished some of that is the misinformation that has gone into it, because the many people I speak to that are against it have got completely misinformed information, and that's because officers have sat down in this council in a room, explained to people the processes that they're going through for procurement, for costs,
the design process and all the details that they've asked, answered all those questions. The same people have walked out of the room and told a completely different story. Okay? And that has misinformed much of the community. So it makes it very, very difficult for us to come to an opinion that somebody can get 50% of the community are saying yes and 50% of the community are saying no. As far as I'm concerned, I go back to the manifesto place, make the local administration in 2012, we are moving to invest in the park, and that's what we're going to do.
Thanks, Brian. Brian Poole, the last one I've got in the game.
Thank you. I guess, Andrew prepared to expect more of this kind of stuff between now and where Labour members, maybe I'll see the SNP members doing politics on this, and I guess the SNP members, of course, here, maybe I'll be seeing Labour doing politics on this, and both might be very hard, so I'm quite sure. For my part, what I would say is if this is so important to stop, then it should have been brought forward last year. I just think the big problem in the 4 months leading up to the election for me, maybe I'm cynical. Well, I am cynical. It's just too much of a coincidence for me to drop forward at this stage. The cycle circuit, I'm just amazed that we could actually think we're jeopardising that at this stage, and the reputation of Fife to not so strong in the game on that issue would be very unlikely. For my part, I'm trying to figure out what might happen, if this was delayed. The third alternate is Sarah figures herself, the cost definitely increase, that's a certainty to put that in the officers. Quite probably, given the work that we're going on in the current centre, there is a percentage in there this time. Would we get a better design at the end of the we may get a different design and get more money. But whether that would be a better design would be really a great subject. As like I said earlier, I think we can decide and I don't think wrong with I think officers have said themselves that the consultation could have been better, and that is kind of what gives that option to look at that is in the motion, given this to go to scrutiny, I think. So for me, the only delay result in anything better, and I just for life of me, I can't see how it can, unless we're going to substantially increase the budget. Given the current budget situation, that's just impossible. So we're kidding ourselves on. So the likelihood we would delay this, we would go to consultation and we would come back and we would do exactly the same thing. So accepting that there's arguments for and against, and I accept the right and the passion of some of that local community are. But we don't know what the community is yet, so we're going to ask that bill from the new, and I'm sure there'll be some people who'll be equally passionate for it. So given the pros and cons, I think the risks for delaying this are greater than for the going ahead with it. So on that basis, I won't be supporting the motion.
Thanks. To sum up.
I always say it is for as I understand it, it's the way if you are a member of the official appointment and the delivery services on behalf of the council on behalf of the patient. So, is that
Very different views in that community, and that community is split. I've talked to a whole range of people there, and there are very different views and a split in that community. In terms of the building size, that has been an issue we've heard, that because of the more efficient and the better use of public space and the wasted space in the current building and the non-accessible space, it is virtually equivalent. In terms of the costs, we've heard that it has been tendered robustly and it is value for money, and that has been confirmed by our officers. We've heard that separating the contracts or delaying the contracts will incur significant additional costs and won't get us any further forward in terms of what we are able to deliver. In fact, it was jeopardised, unless there was significant additional funding going in, it would jeopardise our ability to provide any new circuit there. In terms of the cycle circuit, again, like Mark, I think that is a totally inappropriate suggestion to conflate the two and to suggest that we don't go ahead with that. I've been present at a number of very significant consultation events on that, and that has 100% support from the cycling community across Fife and will be a major asset to our tourism offer going forward. And to suggest we stop with that and lose £600,000 of external funding to it is just not acceptable to me. We've heard a number of interventions from Willie Clark. I've read Willie's letter and I know his view on the matter. But what is important and comes across in Willie's letter to him is there needs to be a visitor centre there in that park over the summer period. And the only way, sure way, of actually delivering that is to go forward with provision of a new centre. I've also talked to Mary Rocker, and Mary's view, she has been taking soundings in her local community. Her view is the community is split almost down the middle. Her judgment is that because of that split, she would prefer it to pause. My judgment is that split, we need to go ahead. Once the thing is in place, I think people will see the benefits of it. And that is the bottom line, is this is a significant £1.8 million investment which will benefit the local Meadows and the surrounding communities. And on that basis, I think throwing it up in the air and questioning whether or not we are able to deliver something in future is the wrong thing to do. So I will be pressing ahead to propose that we do go ahead on the basis of what I've suggested. So I will go with the vote.
Motion by yourself, seconded by Councillor Erskine, is that in terms of the recommendations asked to move the changes to management arrangements between formally award contract for the proposed new visitor centre and the golf club by changing the pavilion. Also understanding order 10 is that this is the decision not the subject to call it, but that separately the first amendment by Councillor Bain, seconded by Councillor Goodall, is to award the contract only for the golf and football facility, to agree that the visitor centre be put on hold, and also agree that the cycle track project for Glen Craig be put on hold pending the outcome of further discussions on this issue.
The second one is agree that the current visitor centre be reinstated with the new development put on hold pending the full consultation.
Thanks. Second amendment, by Councillor Dennis, the second Councillor here, is to award the contract to the Golf and Football Facility to refer the issue of the visitor centre and the whole process to the scrutiny committee for further consideration. There are votes for Councillor Dennis's amendment first. Could I have votes for the First Amendment, which is Councillor Baines, please? And could I have votes for the motion, please, which is? Votes are motion 10, First Amendment 6, Second Amendment 2, and as the motion has the overall majority, it is carried.
Thanks for the